Hello, and welcome to Dana-Farber's live video web chat series. I'm Allison Dibiaso, a social worker at Dana-Farber, and today we'll be talking about parenting during cancer treatment. Joining me today is Sarah Silvia, a Dana-Farber lymphoma and stem cell transplant patient and mom of three. Welcome, Sarah.
Thank you.
Also joining us is Kelly Drummond, who is Sarah's social worker and also my colleague here at Dana-Farber. And Kelly and I both work very closely with the Family Connections program, which we will be talking about today, and to share advice for managing cancer as a family. Thank you for joining us, Kelly.
Thank you, Allison.
If you have any questions for Kelly or Sarah, you can email it to webchats@dfci.harvard.edu. You can also follow along and submit questions via Twitter by tweeting at Dana-Farber using the hashtag DFCIWebChat. So let's get started. Welcome, Sarah and Kelly. Sarah, tell me a little bit about when you were diagnosed with cancer and what that was like for you as a mom.
Well, I was diagnosed in October of 2013, mm-hmm. and the beginning stages of that were obviously very difficult, but almost it didn't really hit me mm-hmm. at first. Mm-hmm. But as that time rolled on, I had a hard time. I contemplated how to tell my children at that time. Mm-hmm. Like you said, I have three boys,
yeah.
and their age range that spanned. My oldest was 12, and I had a middle of 9, and my youngest was 5. So it took me a little while to mm-hmm. wrap my head around it, mm-hmm. but I finally did. I decided as a mom to have a sit down with them mm-hmm. to explain what was going on with me. They mm-hmm. knew I had been sick, but didn't know the severity of it. So mm-hmm. I had that sit down with them and explained to them what was going on and that I had cancer.
Mm-hmm.
At that moment, I knew that they had different times of comprehending what that really meant. My mm-hmm. youngest didn't really comprehend much,
mm-hmm.
But my older one knew of a student he went to school with that mm-hmm. did have it. So he had a little bit more of a connection of an experience. And
sure.
My middle one only knew that cancer made people die. So that was the beginning stages of being a mom and how to handle that mm-hmm. and starting treatment at the same time.
Okay. So it sounds like all three of your boys had a different reaction.
They did. Absolutely.
Yeah.
But yet still very quiet, and we were around a dinner table, and then 2 minutes later, they were back to their normal life at the same time. So
yes.
That really goes to show you where kids are at in that moment.
Yes, absolutely.
And in trying to process.
Yes.
So it's not unusual for kids that are told about a parent with cancer that they don't take it in right away.
Yeah, very good point. And it sounds like when you did learn of your diagnosis, you immediately decided to tell your children.
I did. I felt that was important because I would be undergoing some physical changes
mm-hmm.
In a few weeks after, so I didn't want to wait too long.
Sure. So Kelly, tell me, are those typical reactions for children of parents who have cancer? And also, are there any other reactions kids may have that may be the same or different? What has been your experience?
Sure. So I think, you know, those are absolutely typical responses. Kids tend mm-hmm. to take things in, you know, in a different way than adults and differently at different developmental stages. And like Sarah said, they kind of, a few minutes later, went right back to their life and playing
yeah.
and interacting. And, you know, I think short bursts can be really helpful when talking with kids about this. And, you know, different developmental stages, they're going to cope very differently and
yeah.
respond very differently.
Yes. So. And so, Kelly, can you talk a little bit about how these different stages of development may be different from a younger child to a teenager, and maybe give a quick example how, you know, Sarah, you mentioned they all responded differently. And mm-hmm. I'm just wondering, Kelly, what has been your experience with other parents that have children?
Sure, sure, absolutely. So younger kids tend to not be able to understand to the same level as the older
yeah.
kids. So
yeah.
they can't really soak in all of what it means. So,
sure.
you know, giving very simple, basic information, it's important to tell them. The first thing is to be honest with
yes.
them and tell them
yes.
that you have cancer and,
yes.
and what the name of it is.
Yeah.
And for younger kids, it's really important to make sure that you explain that there are going to be some changes, the doctor's going to give you some medicine that might mm-hmm. make it so that you can't, you know, spend as much time with them or play with them as much, but that you still really love them.
Yes.
You're going to try and maintain their normal activities and
yes.
sports and things like that. It's really important to explain that they can't catch it and that they didn't cause it, because
yeah.
for younger kids that tends to be things that they start to think about.
Absolutely.
There's some magical thinking that happens at those ages. For teenagers and a little bit older side, they understand a little bit more.
Yes.
So they can get a little bit more information, and they're going to want to know a little bit more information.
Yeah.
So a little bit more detail about your treatment,
mm-hmm.
what they can expect to see, physical changes, things like that, like Sarah mentioned.
Sure.
And it's important, because at first I didn't want to tell my kids.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to pretend that they didn't need to know.
Yeah.
But with help from Kelly and using those words
yes.
was the best advice I had ever gotten, to explain to them that the doctors will give me medicine and that is going to help me feel better.
Yes.
And keeping it simple was definitely a very important part of my
absolutely
talking to them, especially my younger ones, where she was right. As my preteen at the time,
mm-hmm.
he needed to know a little. He took in a little bit more, because he was that much older and maybe had, like I said, seen
yes.
someone go through it. So
yes.
he had a little bit more experience and a connection.
Mm-hmm.
So, but just reassuring them and being honest at the same time
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
was really helpful for my boys.
Yes.
But not going too far where things that maybe were too in-depth that they couldn't comprehend.
Yes.
Not really going to that point.
So, you know, what both of you are saying, the importance is to be honest
mm-hmm.
and to give them information, but don't overload them
mm-hmm.
because my sense is, as a mom, you're trying to wrap your own mind around
yes.
this.
And
also you want to protect them
yes.
from what I'm hearing.
That's it.
And I wonder for both of you, how did you find the Family Connections program here helpful, you know, in communicating with your children? Both of you, you know, can give some input on that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
I felt like I had just explained
yeah.
having Kelly through that program was amazing.
Yes.
And being able to find words.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Because at that time I didn't have the words.
Yeah.
I at first didn't want to say anything.
Yeah.
Then I didn't know what to say.
Yes.
So having that to reach out to
sure
was incredible.
Mm-hmm. And Kelly, you might want to give a brief information. What
yeah.
is the Family Connections
yeah.
program?
Absolutely, for our viewers.
Yes.
So we have a program here where we do, we have a parent binder, which
mm-hmm.
is, I think, really, really helpful, because it
mm-hmm.
can, for parents, give them the language that they need to say these kinds of things,
yes.
the different developmental stages and what to expect and what
mm-hmm.
to look for, behaviors to look out for, ways to manage them, different resources.
Mm-hmm.
So it can really be very validating and normalizing of the
yeah.
experience that it's important to tell them.
Yeah.
And then for the kids, we have kid packs that are backpacks that usually, for the younger kids, not the teen packs, but the younger kids have stuffed animals in them.
Yeah.
They've got some a coloring book that's about life not always being a day at the beach, and
mm-hmm.
pipe cleaners and a photo album, different things that
mm-hmm.
Help families to talk about it, can give them a way to talk about it, which
yeah.
is really helpful, especially for the younger kids.
Yeah, an activity.
An activity
yes.
to talk
yes.
about it around.
Yes.
So.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it sounds like it was very helpful. And
yeah.
as Kelly said, they have the binder, so you don't have to look at it all at once. You were able to go back to that
yes.
And reach out to Kelly with questions that you may have about that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a question for both of you, aside from a cancer diagnosis, what are some of the other challenges parents may face when you are diagnosed with any health illness and or cancer, besides, you know, your children, any other challenges?
Well, for me,
mm-hmm.
my challenge, I am a single mother, so
mm-hmm.
I had that challenge already.
Yes.
So having the health issues on top of it,
yeah.
I know just commuting in and out of the city,
yeah.
was a challenge for me, and planning my my children's daily schedules was also a very big challenge. But having a support group at the same time is very important, and getting those challenges met.
Yes.
And those were just daily life was challenging.
Yeah. So you have, you're a single mom.
Yes.
So you are on this path as a single mom, but you also spoke about the importance of reaching out to support.
Yes.
And how important that is when you're dealing with all these challenges, besides the physical challenges of having cancer.
Right.
Yeah. Anything you want to add, Kelly, that you have found?
Well, I think, you know, families come in all shapes and sizes now.
Yeah.
And I think we're seeing that a lot. And that's really important to take into account, because there's support in so many different forms. Grandparents, siblings, friends, lots of friends, colleagues. So I think it's important to reach out to them because they're there and they want to help. For some parents, just the challenge of not working and income can be a real scary thing for people, because, you know, it's enough to worry about yourself and being able to afford that, but when you've got kids, that adds a whole nother layer.
Yeah.
So making sure that, you know, they understand and they're talking with their employer about what the resources are available can be really important as well. And us, we're a resource here to talk about it with them.
Yes, I'm glad you mentioned that, because sometimes we come across patients that have nobody. And so I think you're right, reaching out to the team becomes a huge support for patients and children when they have children. And I'm sure for you, you felt very similar as you spoke about your team and the importance.
Yeah.
Even though you had friends, you felt they were really you're holding ground here.
They really were.
Yeah.
And I have to say, it was for them that I was able to overcome a lot of my challenges to get through. But yes, having other support systems for different reasons was also important.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So just to shift gears a little bit, Sarah, you underwent a transplant as part of your treatment, which includes significant time in the hospital and in isolation. What were some of the ways you sought out additional support for your family during that time? Meaning when you're, you know, I think you mentioned you were in the hospital over 20 days.
Yes.
And it's isolating.
Yes.
And I wonder, what were some of the ways you were able to reach out for yourself, for your children, for some additional support?
That was a challenge for sure. But
what was challenging?
Just to be in that environment with feeling like nobody was there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, they were. Phone calls, emails, text messages, visitors. I was able to have visitors.
Yes.
Most of my immediate family is out of state.
Yeah.
But having them plan to come see me and take turns almost to occupy that time was helpful. I did have my, again, Dana-Farber support that came in to visit with me and gave me someone to talk to. And obviously my nursing staff, incredible people.
Yeah.
And just having people to
and
visit.
Social media.
And social
it sounds
media,
like that was a
goodness.
Huge
yeah.
Connection to the outside world, which is really a gift today.
It really is.
You know,
I utilized it a lot.
Yes, I'm really glad to hear that.
It made me feel more connected.
Yes.
FaceTime,
amazing. Yeah.
I felt that my boys were there with me.
That's a great point.
Yes,
absolutely.
I did get that opportunity because of social media to have face-to-face contact, which was great at the same time when they couldn't be there.
Yeah, and they were able to see you.
And they were able to see me and know that, okay, she's still my mom and she's getting through this, and she still sounds like my mom. And
telling me what to do.
Yes, and you know, to some degree, still looks like my mom.
Yeah,
so
here I am.
Yeah. And it was amazing to have that, and highly recommended.
Great.
If able to have that.
Yeah.
Kelly, any thoughts? Because you only work in transplant and, you know, in lymphoma, which a lot of your patients have transplant, and they hospitalize for quite a long time.
Yep.
And many are isolated, and those that don't have anybody, I'm just wondering if you have any feedback on that.
So one of the things that sometimes people find helpful is making sure that they know what the schedule is going to look like while they're hospitalized, and that way they can communicate that to their kids. So who's going to be picking you up from school? Who's going to be getting you to practice and making you dinner? And, you know, what the schedule is going to be, because kids do well when they know what to expect.
Yes.
And as much as we can provide that, where there's so many unknowns in this, mm-hmm. it really can be beneficial. So yeah. making sure you outline that ahead of time. Yeah. And that applies for treatments. You know, a lot of times patients are hospitalized even for 2 or 3 days mm-hmm. for treatment.
Yeah.
And as much as they can plan for that ahead of time yeah. and tell their kids, communicate what that's going to look like, that's very helpful for
kids. Very helpful. And mine was through a summer. So my kids were on summer vacation,
uh-huh.
and we did a summer where they would be visiting with different family members for weeks at a time, and mm-hmm. and they were able to stay occupied at the same time, but knew that was coming,
yeah. mm-hmm.
knew they were going to be at family members' houses at certain times, and it was almost like their vacations,
yeah,
different vacations. Yeah.
So communicating up front, being honest, mm-hmm. and also structure,
yep.
it mm-hmm. sounds right. like is very helpful.
Definitely.
You know, this question both of you can answer, but I'll start with you, Sarah. Mm-hmm. You know, having a parent with cancer may affect children's performances and activities and at school with their friends. And what advice do you have for communicating with children's schools or their friends or their friends' parents or activity groups? Any thoughts? And then I reach out to you, Kelly.
I did. I immediately contacted all of the guidance departments mm-hmm. at my children's school.
Yep.
And I explained what was going on with me.
Yep.
And I thankfully had a great support in the school that they were able to mm-hmm. check on my children, call them, have little lunch meetings mm-hmm. To a degree where they weren't being singled out.
Yeah.
But being overlooked, I was able to reach out to all the teachers,
mm-hmm.
and they knew. And my big message was to keep their day as regular as possible, because that was almost a time where it was normal for
yeah.
them.
Yeah.
And to keep that consistency
yes.
was important for me.
Absolutely.
And that's how I handled it. And as far as sporting activities, I, again, had that support system where friends and family would be in contact with me. I'll be picking them up to take them to practice
yeah.
or bringing them home for practice
yeah.
and just keeping that schedule flowing.
And the communication.
Yes.
So you, again, were open and honest.
Yes.
With
that I needed help.
Yeah.
It's okay to ask for help.
Yes.
And it
I'm really glad you said that.
At
yep.
the beginning, very hard, mm. but through my help here, mm-hmm. I was able to say, I can't do this alone, and I need to ask, and people want to help.
They
sometimes
do.
I found that people were waiting for me.
Yeah.
So it was when I took that leap, I was able to get more of a normal schedule for my children, because it was finally flowing, and I didn't have to worry.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, how am I going to get them?
Yeah. And that is a big worry
it is
for parents. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And Kelly, maybe you could speak a bit about how the Family Connections Program can help parents with the language and what to communicate to schools
sure,
and to,
sure.
you know, coaches mm-hmm. and dance mm-hmm. teachers. And
yeah. So I think it's, you know,
that?
Everyone's very different in how much they want to,
yeah.
how much information they're comfortable giving.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's important to have a good handle on where you are with that and mm-hmm. respect your own boundaries while also taking into account that you're kids are really going to benefit from the people that are in their lives knowing.
Yes.
So yes. making sure that their teachers know is very important, especially because they have eyes and ears on them for 8 hours a day.
Absolutely.
And can understand if there's behavioral challenges or changes or
mm-hmm.
their grades drop or anything like that. They can help to manage that and be on the lookout for that
yeah.
because they spend so much time with them.
Yeah.
And also take that into account so
yeah.
that they can provide support and not have it be punitive,
yes.
but just support. So I think that can be really, really helpful. And there is language in our Family Connections materials about that.
Yes.
And, you know, a lot of times we'll have parents that come to us to just talk that through. How
yes.
how are they going to communicate? Is it okay? I don't want to tell them everything.
Yes, yes.
And that's completely appropriate.
It is. And I think you're right. Reaching out to social work can be very
yeah.
helpful
yeah.
to how do you communicate to outside providers, because people are private
mm-hmm.
and they want to protect their kids.
Of course.
But at the same time, you're right, they're at school 8 hours a day and they want their kids to feel
right.
that they're being taken care
yeah,
of
right.
while you're going through this.
Mm-hmm. Especially and just for teenagers.
Yes,
I want to say
too, that's exactly what
a lot of times won't
yep.
talk to their parents.
Yes,
so
yes.
they do better when they talk to someone that isn't a parent.
Yeah.
So if they have someone at school that they know knows and they don't have to go into too much about it,
that's right.
It can help open that line of communication for teenagers especially.
It's a great point.
It is. And it really worked for my preteen, teen.
Yeah.
He felt like he had that teacher, that go-to, where if he just felt bottled up, that he was able to go and talk.
That's so great.
And that was great. I really had, again, that support on that end.
Yes, and it, like you said, it, teens, they may not go to their parents, but yet they reach out to somebody who's not as close to the
That's
family,
correct.
But a connection's there.
Mm-hmm.
And so, Sarah, you're a teacher
yourself.
Mm-hmm. How do you talk to kids other than your own about your illness and or why you were away from school?
Yeah, well, I was able to, when I left for my, after my diagnosis,
mm-hmm.
I wasn't able to have much contact at that point,
yeah.
But I almost addressed my students
mm-hmm.
the same as my children, to a lesser degree, that I was gonna need to get some medicine and some care from doctors so they could help me feel better.
Yeah.
And I would be out, and then I was out for a lengthy time, and I'll be returning this fall again,
yeah.
And I'm sure there'll be more questions.
Yes.
Because I've been in that district for a long time. I had my support, my principal at my school,
yeah.
He did a lot of the talking, but he reached out to me about what we communicated a lot about what was appropriate.
You collaborated.
Yes. About what to
yes.
say.
And yes.
That was kind of the message I sent to him, and
mm-hmm.
he was able to express that,
yeah.
That I was being treated and being well taken care of,
yeah.
So I could get better.
And you teach the fourth grade?
Fourth grade,
so that
yes.
was really age appropriate.
It was age appropriate.
Yeah, and you're looking forward to going back
I
in September.
Am. I can't wait.
Yeah, I bet they're looking forward to seeing you.
Mm-hmm.
And Kelly, what are some of the questions children may typically ask when a parent or another adult in their life is diagnosed with cancer? They may ask you, because many parents bring their
mm-hmm.
kids in and they see us,
mm-hmm.
and you may meet alone with them,
mm-hmm.
pending their age, and I'm just
yeah.
wondering, are there any other
yeah.
questions they may typically ask, and how do you find, as a social worker, the Family Connections program
yeah.
helpful?
Yeah, so, you know, for kids, a lot of times what they're worrying about is very immediate, and you know
mm-hmm.
how are their needs going to be met, which is
yeah.
completely appropriate. Sometimes they'll ask, depending on their age, it's very different. Sometimes they'll ask about
yeah.
what it's going to mean in terms of changes in the household, what that's going to look like,
mm-hmm.
who's going to be taking care of me. Sometimes kids will ask, you know, are you going to die? That's one that a lot of times kids ask, and it's a hard
mm-hmm.
question and scary for parents to get that question, I think.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, it's important in situations like that to be, again, honest with them
mm-hmm.
and to give them the information that you have, which
mm-hmm.
is the doctors are giving me medicine to help make me better. And
yeah.
and when I get any information, I'm going to tell you, making sure that they feel like there's an open communication there and they can ask questions.
Yes.
And if you don't have the answer, that's okay. You're
yes.
going to get it from the doctor.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And, you know, to that point, you know, Sarah, Kelly and I as social workers learned that is one of the kids' biggest fears.
Yes,
you know, will my mom or dad die from this cancer?
Mm-hmm.
And I just wonder if that question came up for you
it
with
did.
Your children, and how did you respond, if you can share a little bit about what was helpful or not, or what
yeah.
worked for you?
Yeah, because I have three boys with three different personalities,
mm-hmm.
it did come up amongst one of them.
Mm-hmm.
They may hear more at school,
yes.
kids talking
yes.
or kids
mm-hmm.
telling them things
yes.
that their parent will die.
Yeah.
And that was upsetting. So that came out from my middle son, Dominic, and
mm-hmm.
he asked me if I was. And I, again, used a lot of my language from Kelly
yeah.
to reassure him that that was not going to happen, that I was going to have medicine to help me feel better, and
mm.
that I would tell him if anything were changing. But right now, through my process, that things were going in the right direction, basically.
Yeah.
And that just kept him, I guess, okay with that. He was okay with hearing that I was okay.
Yes.
And he was my worrier and needed to hear that often, that I was doing okay, and I would tell him what my doctor had said, that I was doing good.
Yes.
And if anything changed, I would definitely tell him.
Yes.
And again, it's hard as a parent to have to even think about having that discussion.
Yeah.
And you want to protect them 100%, and you don't want to talk about death. And that was probably one of my biggest challenges.
Yeah.
Is I didn't personally want to talk about it, because in my own mind, that's not how I felt.
Yes.
I felt I was wanting to live.
Yes.
And that was my message to my children.
Yes.
That I was going to fight and do what I could.
And it sounds like your doctors were given similar message that
yes.
you were
yes.
doing well through your transplant.
Yes.
You were
and I knew they were being honest with me.
Yes.
And I could be honest with them. Right. At that moment in time, we're doing good.
Yeah.
We're doing really well. We're doing, it's, my body is doing what it's supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
And getting ready for transplant.
Yeah.
And one of the things I think, you know, that's so important that you mentioned is that you were honest with him, and even though you didn't want to go there, it's hard for a parent to go there, so you didn't want to go there, but you gave him the space to, which I think is really, really important, because a lot of times parents are afraid to talk about that too, because that's their biggest fear.
That's right.
You know, it's important to give kids the space and feel comfortable to come with to you with these questions, because they're going to carry it around if they're not talking about it with you. And it's important to be honest, because they do hear things from kids at school or
That's
TV.
Right.
So getting the information from you first and honestly is very important, because it builds that trust. So they know that they can come to you with questions and that you're being honest with them.
And also, you said he was your warrior.
Yes.
So you immediately felt you needed to have that conversation with him, so he didn't internally hold that worry.
And that's important.
Yeah.
Because the more they hold in, that's when, just as being a teacher even.
Yeah, great point.
Seeing
yep.
the breakdown of their life and where they're not doing well at school. And and I knew that I couldn't let that happen, so I had to keep that opened. And that was important. But again, not going into too much detail.
Because you didn't know.
Right.
You gave him the information you knew and that he
terms.
Developed.
Right.
Exactly, that he could understand.
Yeah.
And so the transition off treatment can be confusing for children. So Sarah, now that you're out of active treatment, how has your family changed? How has the dynamic in your family changed now that you're through your transplant, you're off treatment, you look fantastic, you said you feel well, you go back to school. How did the kids adapt to this whole nother new normal routine?
Well, they did.
Yeah.
I luckily, I was able to keep that routine.
Great.
Going to some degree, so, but yet it's at a different level now.
Yeah.
They see mom with more energy, and they see mom look different, obviously now, and do things and go places.
Yes.
And kids
more
are
active.
Yes. Kids are very resilient, and believe it or not, I was able to some degree hold my rules even, because that might come up too. They'll overstep their boundaries because you're not as strong to hold those boundaries. So that's important to try to do, and just keep it going now, just reminding them that we have rules and boundaries, but yet now we can do so much more. It's definitely happier. I mean, having that chance this summer to do things has changed our dynamics. We're very close family. I have a great relationship with all of them. And you know, we're able to still talk about cancer and what it did and how it felt, and reflect on where we were at a year ago and 2 years ago, and now where we're at, and it gives them hope.
Yes, absolutely.
And even if you had somebody else that you knew that went through something, to give them hope.
Yes.
Not everybody dies from cancer.
That's right.
Yeah.
And we all need hope.
Yes, we do.
Absolutely. And so, Kelly, what advice do you have for parents who might go through a recurrence of having an advanced cancer? And tell me, how do you thoughts or recommend they should communicate the reality of this disease to the family?
So that's a big concern that comes up. And,
yeah.
you know, for... The similar rules apply as the first time around.
Yes.
Being honest,
yes.
You know, it's an upsetting thing. It's an emotionally charged time too. So sometimes parents can't get through that conversation without a little help.
Yeah.
So sometimes it's helpful to have another family member around that can, if you become emotional, which is appropriate, but could be upsetting and hard to get through that conversation, they can kind of help pick that up and give the information and reassure the child or children that there's still gonna be people there to take care of them and that their mom or dad loves them and, you know, they're gonna do the best that they can. So I think it's a similar situation. Being honest is really important.
So. Yes, anything you wanna add to that?
No, that was well said. That's, it's important. Yeah. I don't have, we're hoping that it's not gonna get to that point for me.
Yes, absolutely, and you know, you're doing great and you've been clear about that and you look fantastic. And I just to, you know, my last question for you is, now that you've gone through this experience of parenting during cancer, is there anything you would have done differently or advice you would give to other parents? Or not do differently?
Right. I think I reflect on that a lot. I really can't identify anything that I do differently.
Yeah.
I think what I did right and well. It took me, like I said in the beginning, a little while to, but my support helped me through that stage. Maybe I could have reached out a little sooner, but I think everything else I felt very appropriate with. And my advice is just, again, hold on to hope and be honest and try to make your children's lives as normal and positive, stay positive for them.
Yes, and I also think too, there's no right or wrong.
No,
there's no right or wrong in what you do, as long as, from what I heard from you both today, is to be honest and to communicate. And that's important.
And remind them that they are loved.
Exactly.
Yes,
so
absolutely.
You're there, still there for
them.
Absolutely.
That's right.
We do have a couple questions that have come in through email, and I thought I could bring them up. Is how can parents prepare their children for the physical changes they may experience? We talked a little bit, but I wanted to mention, so if you could just, you know, briefly say a little bit about that.
Yeah, I actually have that experience, and it came from my youngest, that he was 5, knowing that he couldn't wrap his head around that cancer. He loved my hair and was upset about that, but I prepared him, it would happen, and I again, stayed positive that I still am mom, and I will look different, and it never seemed, we kept rolling with it.
Great.
I felt.
You normalized it.
I even had one of my sons, he wanted to shave his head to look like mom.
And did he?
And did he.
Great.
And it was great. It was
so you normalized it.
Yes,
absolutely.
I did. Very normalized.
And just my the last question that came in, are there any tasks related to treatment you can give your children to do to make them feel part of the process and to be involved?
A couple things that I thought were helpful is I was able to bring my children with me on one occasion.
Which is a wonderful idea.
Best thing I ever did.
Yep.
They felt part of it.
Yep.
They felt they were spending the day with mom.
Yep.
They met my team. They just glowed and...
Well, they saw.
They saw.
They witnessed that, oh, is this what you do?
Yes, this is, this is it.
Yeah.
Right. It seems
that's
so
what
scary.
I hear from children. Yes,
it
yes,
was
yes, yes,
so
absolutely.
Highly,
yes, great point,
Kelly. If it's possible, recommend that.
Absolutely.
But just, again, making them feel as they're part of that.
Thank you both. And I really appreciate you coming in and sharing your story and speaking about the Family Connections Program and how helpful as you, Kelly, as a social worker. So that wraps up today's live web chat. Again, thank you both for your insight and your advice for parents parenting during cancer. To rewatch this web chat, visit www.danafarber.org/parentingchat. And also for more information for parenting during cancer, visit danafarber.org/familyconnections.